But I think those rules of storytelling can vary. And what's been so exciting about musicals in the last several years is that a lot of things that are not formulaic have gotten attention.
I wanna be a producer with a hit show on Broadway.
You're listening to the Producer's Perspective Podcast with your host, Tony Award winner, Ken Davenport.
That's the genie from Aladdin wishing you into today's podcast. And if you know this podcast, then you know the genie from Aladdin does a lot to inspire a lot of conversation here. But here today, he's doing twice the job because he's also the perfect introduction to today's guest of the podcast, Ken Cerniglia, who was the dramaturge for Disney for over 15 years. He actually worked on Aladdin, but he works independently as well, worked on Hadestown, a whole bunch of stuff. He's going to tell you exactly what a dramaturge is and what it does, which is a question I've actually had for many, many years. And we get into quite a conversation about it. But before we get to that conversation, I want to thank my pal Justin Guarini for sponsoring today's podcast with his audition secrets. Now, look, let me tell you something. I see a lot of auditions as a producer, a lot. And this is for all you actors out there. It is very obvious to me the people who work on their auditions, who master the craft of auditioning, which is like its whole own thing, a very important skill, and the people that just walk in the door and wing it. Guess who gets the jobs? That's right, the people who work on the craft of auditioning. And Justin has a whole program called the Audition Secrets, okay? You can get it at justinguarini.com or click the link in my blog or in the episode notes to get in contact with Justin to book one of his 40-minute online vocal audition audits. I mean, this is so smart. You gotta get good at this stuff. And you'll work together with him online in a face-to-face audition audit. You'll discover your own personal connection to the material. You'll learn how to calm your nerves. Like, this is something he talks about very specifically. Yeah, because even Justin gets nervous. He's gonna tell you how to calm yours. And he's going to record the whole thing, send it back to you. You're going to learn a ton. And I'm telling you, just one of these audits, just one, will make you a better auditioner. If you're a better auditioner, you're more likely to get the gig. So again, click the link in my blog or in the episode notes to get in contact with Justin and book that online vocal audition audit today. And now let's get to that podcast with the other Ken.
So whether we have white or copper skin,
Ken Davenport here. Welcome back to the Producer's Perspective Podcast. My name is Ken Davenport. Today, we are discussing something I know very little about. Professional dramaturgy, like dramaturges, something like that. And we're going to do it with one of the best in the biz. Please welcome to the podcast, Ken Cerniglia. Welcome, Ken.
Thanks for having me.
I like your first name.
It's great. Yeah,
it's a good one. Okay, so Ken, to give you a little background, Ken was the dramaturge on the innovative Broadway hit Hadestown, which I think he did a pretty good job on that show. Won 8 Tony Awards, including Best Musical. We just had Mara Isaacs, the producer, on just a few weeks ago. Also was the dramaturge on Peter and the Star Catcher, and was the resident dramaturge for Disney theatrical productions for 16 years with the mouse. That's amazing. Developing over 70 titles for Broadway, touring international and licensed productions. I can't wait to get into the differences of all those things, including Hunchback of Notre Dame, Freaky Friday, Aladdin, Newsies, Little Mermaid, and so on and so on. He was the past president of the Literary Managers and Dramaturges of America. And get this, he holds a PhD in theater history and drama criticism from the University of Washington. Does that mean I should call you doctor?
You can if you like.
But do people call you doctor?
I don't require it. Some people do.
They do?
Yeah.
I think you deserve it. How many years in school was that?
Oh, let's see. Grad school was altogether 5 years. Yeah. And wow. I did like 5 or 6 years in undergrad because I was a glutton for education.
So tell me, what is the path to being a dramaturge? I made a joke in the introduction about not knowing what this is. And really, it's because in the commercial theater world, it doesn't exist as much as it does in nonprofit. I hear about nonprofits and they assign a dramaturge. If only we did that. It sounds like some producers like Mara were smart enough to do that. So tell me, what was your path to becoming this thing?
It's an interesting path. I did my undergrad at UC San Diego, where the La Jolla Playhouse is in residence there. And while I was there in the Department of Theater and Dance, they had an MFA program in dramaturgy. So it had been established already, and I was aware of it. And they had, there at the La Jolla Playhouse was a resident dramaturg who recently passed away, unfortunately early, Robert Blacker. So it was sort of in my constellation of like, these are things that one could do in the theater. Although when I was an undergrad, I got a psychology degree, but then I double majored in theater. And you know, like many people, I was focusing on performance, got a little bit into directing and producing while I was there, but hadn't really had the call yet to pursue a career as a dramaturg until I went to grad school. So I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do. I just know that I knew that I wanted to learn more about theater. So I decided to pursue grad school on an academic path because I'd had some mentors in undergrad who got PhDs, were theater historians or theorists or scholars, but also maybe did some directing, still participated in making theater, which I wanted to do. But I loved studying it. Like, what was it about? And I was always asking the big questions. Like, yeah, I saw the play that was amazing, but like, what does it mean? How does it engage culture? Philosophical questions, those sorts of things. So when I went to, from San Diego, I moved to Washington, D.C. to pursue my master's degree there at Catholic University, which has one of the oldest drama departments in the country, and actually sort of had the first professional theater there on campus. Father Harkey founded the drama department, and that's before there was, you know, arena stage there. That's where the people in government went to go see theater for a few decades before Zelda founded arena stage. So they had a lot of history there. Anyway, I was first semester in my MA in theater history and criticism, and I had a class in dramaturgy, my first official class. Even though like I'd known dramaturgs, I've been taught by dramaturgs, this is my first class. I'm like, all right, I'm gonna learn about this a little bit more formally. And at that point, there were probably maybe two books in existence about dramaturgy. But we had the literary manager from Arena Stage come and visit our class, Kathy Madison, and she told us about the work that she did. And I was fascinated by it, and I thought, and she had an internship, and I applied for it, and I got it the next year. So in the, dating myself, in the 97-98 season, I was the literary intern there. And I was assigned to two of the eight shows as the dramaturg. And so it was basically applying everything I was learning in school to the making of a show. So the context of it, I worked on two shows, which are sort of the two types of production dramaturgy. One was a Eugene O'Neill play, and the other was a new play by John Klein, a domestic comedy. So I got to do research into A Touch of the Poet, and bring that research, and like, Eugene O'Neill wrote this play, what were the original circumstances of it, what does this thing mean, to bring in research and context to make new decisions about reviving the play. What is it going to mean now?
I want to stop you just there, because I think that's where there's so much confusion about what you do, and I'm just learning as we go, because I only think about dramaturgy, of course, when I'm creating something new, and here you are talking about dramaturgy at Eugene O'Neill play, and I'm like, what? Well, the guy wasn't around. Like, what was he telling him to rewrite the second act? Like, no, you're talking about a whole different form of research about it.
And so, yes, it's different applications of the same skill set, essentially. So, if a dramaturg is trained in theater history, dramatic literature, sort of like both broad and deep, and bringing that knowledge and skill set to a production, it can be with an existing text and maybe a playwright who's no longer around. And so then the dramaturg would be maybe the advocate for that playwright and in the room, which is a lot of what production dramaturgy is sometimes known for, and why, you know, regional theaters maybe have someone on staff, is like, well, someone needs to know that or bring it to.
Someone needs to represent O'Neill in the room. Like, hey, you know, his like mother had just died, so there may be a concept or the Industrial Revolution.
We should know where this came from so we can make decisions about how to produce it now. And even though, you know, that play was written decades ago, we're producing it tonight. It has to have meaning tonight. So we need to be able to translate context and bridge the gap. And also maybe the audience might want to know a little bit more about where this play came from to be able to engage with it tonight, but also has to have merit tonight. So we need to make decisions about it. So that same skill set can actually be brought to bear in the development of a new play, too. It's just working with a living playwright. So the dramaturg doesn't need to be the advocate for the playwright who's already there, but may also serve that function. But it's about the context too, and bringing in history. And you know, in the case of a new play, the dramaturg functions. You know, there are many analogies you can use, but say publishing houses have editors who develop relationships with writers and read drafts and give feedback and help make the thing what it needs to be. But at the end of the day, the thing gets published and the author's name is on it. But it doesn't mean there wasn't someone else working on that. And I think a dramaturg for new work is often in that position of being, you know, a cheerleader, a sounding board, an in-house critic about what about this kind of thing. Not just for the writer, but actually for the whole team. So, you know, working to, you know, with producers, with directors, with designers, just being part of the creative conversation at the service of the work. So, you know, I like to say when I'm working on new work, I'm the suggester, not the decider, but I want to bring in the question. So like my work is always at the service of a writer's voice and a director's vision, and just being there without, you know, it's not my voice and vision, but I'm in it and I'm an advocate for it. And I'm also try to be part of the process for refining the voice and the vision and getting it to work together. Like, I'm there for the project and trying to bring often, you know, some of the same analytical skills that theater critics have, but bringing that into the process before it gets to the audience, before it gets to the evaluation of a critic, and hopefully anticipating those questions that audiences and critics would have, not just about the text itself, but about the context. Mm. What does it mean here and now? Why this play in this place at this time? Asking the bigger questions. And you know, and bringing experience from other shows, other work, other times to bear, like what's relevant here.
So tell me about your actual process. So if I were to, I've got like 17 scripts over here in my office, right on my desk. If I were to throw you, like, here, I want you to dramaturge this. What's the first thing you do besides obviously read it? Like, what, tell me your process.
Engaging new work. Because sometimes people ask me to, you know, take a look at something. And so my practice now is essentially trying to get and limiting my time, because everything leads to something else and you can go down any kind of rabbit hole. So I try to limit my time when I'm first engaging a work and try to like give 30 minutes to reviewing materials.
Even a full script.
I won't necessarily read the whole script. So I'll see some video, listen to some things, try to get my first impression of like, what is this thing? So I'll do that first, and then I'll dedicate the second, so 1 hour, like free consultation. Second hour is dedicated to a conversation, because dramaturgy is about process, hopefully to get to the best product possible, but it's about process. How do you lay out a conversation? What is this? Why are we here? Essentially asking the most fundamental question, like, what is this thing? Why are you doing it? Why are we here? Why is this going to call itself into an event that will be a community event, because that's what theater is. So I want to understand, like, what, where's the fire in it? Why are you doing it? Why is it here? I want to be engaged in it too. So that's really what the first thing, like, what is this thing, you know? And some of it's about genre, some of it's about where did it come from, just the context. I want to see, like, just get as quickly as possible, what is this thing? And why are we here? So, because I think, you know, once you commit to something, you lose sight of that, you know, that first impression or that why are we here, and you just dive in, you know, you get committed and you lose sight of how someone might come to this thing fresh.
Well, you know why you're there. Like, you've been working on a show for 4 years and you assume everyone knows why you're there. And often it's like, no, I don't understand what this means. Well, of course it means X, Y, and Z and yeah. A, B, and C. It's like, well, it's not clear on the page.
Yeah. So some of the work is about clarity. And, you know, one of the great things, many things, you know, I learned working at Disney for 16 years, but it's about widening the audience. And increasing the welcome, and making sure there's always something in every project I work on that someone can come in off the street without knowing anything and find some point of engagement and welcome in a project. So particularly when we're deep into something that, you know, it's important not to play inside baseball. Now, there's some projects that are very niche for a very specific audience, and that's totally okay. But in working on particularly work that's going to be in a commercial model, and you know all that means is that your ticket sales have to pay all the bills. That's all the difference there is. It's still people who love theater, it's just a different model for how the event can happen and who pays for it. But that also means you need to sell as many tickets as possible. And so that means you need to increase the welcome as much as possible that's still true to the work. And those are the questions that I bring. It's like, how can we actually open this up more? And it's a big difference that increasing the welcome does not mean dumbing down or lowest common denominator. It just means, because the theater can operate on many levels of meaning at once, it means making sure there's one level of meaning and interpretation that's accessible to someone who doesn't know anything. So, for example, for Hadestown, well, it's super cool for people who are mythology geeks to engage this telling of a story, which is, you know, comes from the brain of Aeneas Mitchell. There's a lot of people for whom this is the first encounter with mythology at all. And so we need to tell the story from scratch. And that's an important part of the work that I do, is really trying to keep some distance and perspective so that I can come back into the room and ask the question again, why are we here? What's the mission? What are we doing? To keep the, you know, perspective on the forest while people are working on the trees.
It's a fascinating insight, because I was actually going to ask next, do you have a different process for looking at Aladdin versus looking at Hadestown?
For sure. And because, you know, this is the, well, I've worked with singer-songwriters before. Like, you know, I got to work with Phil Collins. It was one of my first jobs at Disney, is working on Tarzan with Phil Collins, who's the nicest person in the world. But I was still, like, I'm still sort of, like, awestruck by him. But, you know, he's a guy from the music world. He's a songwriter and a drummer and a singer. And so, you know, his approach to songs is songs that stand alone. And that's the key difference in musical theater, is that the songs work together. There's a score to build. But he'd already, you know, provided some songs for the Disney movie in the 90s. So this was the coming back to it. But working with Aeneas, now she had created Hadestown initially as part of, like, a community theater sort of exploration of it. So there was some dramatic context, but it's still very much in the vibe of a songwriter, a song cycle. There's a story to tell. There's a story that she relied on there. And so it was really trying to figure out what the DNA of Hadestown was. So I had to, and she'd already been working on it for almost a decade before I came into the picture, and also working on it for a couple of years with Rachel before I came. So I had to just go to school on it. And I think because I'm a curious person, I'm well suited to the task of, like, all right, what is this world? Where does this come from? Who are you as a writer? And what is this thing? And I had to learn the DNA of this thing that's not different, but that is different from anything that I'd worked on before. Because Aeneas was very keen on not writing a traditional book musical, like that Hadestown already had its own identity. It was just bringing it into a theater versus, you know, outdoors or touring as a concert. This was going to be at the theater for the first time in this iteration in New York Theater Workshop. So the context was, people were going to come experience Hadestown at a playhouse. So they're thinking play. And so we had to do the work to figure out how to make Hadestown its thing and true to itself and her voice, but also a play. So what are the rules of playwriting? What are Hadestown's rules of playwriting? And so I didn't know coming in what it would be. I had to discover what the dramaturgy of the piece was And it was a, you know, an iterative process, and I think we got to a place where we were pretty happy with it, and that we found that people from different places of knowledge about mythology or music could come and feel engaged in some way. And so I think that just talking to different audience members and see them engaged with the show, I'm like, oh, okay, I did it. I did, you know, I did my part to make that, to help make that happen.
Are you surprised by its success?
Yes. I knew that it was good, and I mean, you've already talked to Mara about it, and you know what, she's a great leader on the project, is that she helped articulate that, that the art was going to be first, and that Hadestown does know what it is. And so anyone coming on her caravan to help work on the show was going to be at the service of this thing, and then just to have faith in it. Because, you know, as you know, working on commercial theater, like, there's a lot of money to raise, there's a lot of people involved, and there can be a lot of voices and a lot of opinions. And it's hard to just figure out, like, which one's right, how to do the thing. And so keeping those filtered and in the conversation sort of in a tight group about what's right and what feels right and what feels like the show. At a certain point when you're developing a show, and if you have good ears on, the show will tell you what it needs to be. And, you know, it's a bit of a discernment process. But, you know, there's a appeal to Anais in her voice, you know, as a singer, but also as a writer. And it's very clear, and she's very clear about what she wants to write about and what's important. And so what I found in the conversations about Hadestown, what was useful was something that she had a big conviction about may have been something at the service of the poetry. And in the moment and in the detail just sort of felt right. And so I had to pursue that, because I'm like, well, if you have that, if you feel that strongly that it's right, let's try to make it work. Because something that may be poetically right might be dramaturgically challenging, either that it's sort of not lining up, not consistent with other things. And so I would say that sometimes we had some gimmies, some things that don't necessarily line up or aren't necessarily logical, but the audience will give you some gimmies. And there's a certain tipping point, I don't know, at what, and it's different for everyone, but on a subconscious level, if things don't line up, they're going to start to divest from it, or maybe not trust the storytelling. But there's always some gimmies, that there's just something that's like poetically right in the moment, that's just really good there, that maybe doesn't line up, but it's a gimme, and you just go for it. So I think things can have success, despite some gaps in logic, but never because of them.
How much do you believe in a formula for storytelling, whether that's the monomyth, hero's journey, whatever you want to call it, and especially being from Disney and knowing their belief in these kind of story points or pillars of storytelling,
yeah,
especially in musicals, how much does that apply?
You know, I think like in any field, in any profession, there are best practices. And even Aristotle, when he was writing the Poetics, wasn't establishing rules for tragedy, because we only have some of them for comedy, but the ones for tragedy we have, and it wasn't based on like, he didn't do it in a cave somewhere, he based it on theater going and seeing what worked the best, and these seem to be the things that were in common about what worked the best, whether it's like unity of time and place, and you know, certain things that happen with your protagonist, and so there are some best practices. And so when I talked to writers, I'm like, you know, here's some things that have worked in the past, but I don't think that equates to a formula. What makes something successful is that it's appealing. You know, they've got some characters that are appealing, and you can have, you know, an anti-hero who's just like a bad person, but there's something about that that's appealing. And I think you need to have a clear world and some tell the audience where we are and what's happening, what are the rules of storytelling within the first, you know, 10 or 15 minutes, so then they can not worry about it and just go with you. That's pretty consistent. But I think those rules of storytelling can vary. And what's been so exciting about musicals in the last several years is that a lot of things that are not formulaic have gotten attention. And been appealing and shown themselves to be successful. So I don't think there's a formula, but I think, you know, like anything, you have to learn the rules in order to break the rules. And there are some rules, but that's just based on what's been successful, not that they've been invented in the dark So no, I don't think there's a formula, but I do think every show has a DNA and we need to learn it, but it has to have a reason for being, and it has to have a central appeal to it and a fire to it. Like, why are people going to come to see this thing? That's the question I'm always asking. And for Hadestown, I think it was, there was something really exciting and vibey about the voice. And then everything that's layered into it, like, it's actually not just vibey, it's about something, and it has meaning. And so, you know, the work that I've done on it with the team has been about just wading through a lot of material and getting to the what's the key thing, and what is this melody that he found, and what is this story of the epics, and how does it relate to other things. And and part of it was just being in the world of Hadestown and having it tell us what was key, and then just refine it over time and get it clearer and better and more inviting.
What I love about what you just said, which is something, to be honest, I never imagined a dramaturg saying, is why are people coming to see it? I always think of dramaturgs, I think there's this reputation, it's the word itself, it seems so fancy,
yeah,
that it's like, oh, it's all literary, it's all about the page and the word choice and the history, and this is an anachronism and all these things, when what you're saying is, no, why are people paying $150 to come see this thing? That's your job, is making sure that happens.
Yes, of course. I mean, like, you know,
we're the same. Yeah. That's my job too.
Exactly. But I think, you know, so how do I bring my expertise to it? And, you know, that people have been practicing dramaturgy since theater's been around. There's always been a critical eye to it, and what is it meant, and, you know, anyone who's reviewing it, anyone who's asking questions about it. Practice of dramaturgy is just focusing on the structures of meaning, and, like, how does casting make meaning? I wrote my dissertation on race and representation in American theater from the 19th century to the early 20th century in popular American theater, and, like, actually comes into play in working on musicals now, because it's about what makes meaning for sort of a wide audience, and you know, casting structures make meaning. Who's playing what role in a multiracial society, and casting decisions make meaning. And, you know, what songs in what order make meaning. Mm-hmm. Score has meaning. The text has meaning. All these things. And so it's just bringing those structures into play in a very particular way. And so, you know, people have done the work. Yes, the word dramaturg is a German word. And the practice is a few hundred years old in Germany and Eastern Europe, but relatively new and called such in the United States. But people have been doing it. Like, I work for Disney's almost 100 years old, and they've been practicing dramaturgy the whole time. You know, whether it's called people who do story, or, you know, trying to make it the best thing possible, and doing that work from the inside as part of the process. And so a benefit of having a dramaturg on the team is, like, that's my only job, is to help curate the conversation about it and to work on that, because, you know, Mara's a dramaturgical producer, like, Rachel's a dramaturgical director, but they have other jobs. This is my only job, is to help curate this conversation and be, you know, another voice in the room, but at the service of other people's voice and vision.
What do you, this is a two-part question.
Yeah.
Number one, what do you think is the most perfectly structured musical from a dramaturgical perspective? And number two, what is the musical that you choose to watch every day for the rest of your life if you had to choose one?
That's a good question. Every time I see Fiddler, I do think that's almost a perfectly structured musical. It just works. It's so simple. Why we're here is so clear. It's a famous story about the opening number, but you know, it came from a dramaturgical question. What is this musical about? Well, it's about tradition. Boom, there's the opening number. Tell everyone what it's about right from the outset. And, like, okay, those are the stakes here. This is the story we're telling, but it all comes back to this idea of tradition. So, you know, and there's this, you know, great new production on Yiddish, and so it's, but it works. It just fundamentally works, so it doesn't matter what language it's in. I've seen kids do it. It's almost foolproof. You can interpret it many ways, and, like, the thing still works. And, you know, there are other things that I think, like, oh, why does Book of Mormon work? Because on its surface, you're like, oh, it's just iconoclastic, and it's, you know, and it's foul and vulgar and all that. Like, but underneath, it was written by people who love musical theater, and it's almost perfectly structured. It works at, like, heartwarming in the end, but, like, all of these points, the structure is working. And I think dramaturgy is almost most important in musical theater because there's a lot of things going on. And you can get overwhelmed by spectacle and the fun and all of that. But if underneath it, you've got a structure that can hold it, you can almost do anything on that side. You know, if you've got a house that's well built, has good bones, you can repaint it, you can redecorate it, you can do all the things because the bones are good. And that house will stand. And I think plays are the same way. But if you've got good structure underneath it, you can dress it up. And people won't actually know the structure because it's just working. And so that's what I try to focus on. It's like, what's the structure underneath this thing holding it up? And sometimes I won't even look at the details for a long time in the process because I'm like, we gotta get the structure right. Because you can change the details later. But if something has a flaw in structure, it's very difficult to fix later.
And what's that musical that you'd watch every day for the rest of your life? Your favorite?
I think just because it was meaningful to me growing up, but The Sound of Music.
Yeah. Another very well-structured musical from...
Sure. And stakes are high. You know, that's set in a, you know, based on a true story and set in the backdrop of something very meaningful.
Do you think any idea can be a musical if it's structured properly? Or are there some things that should not be musicals?
I think there are many things that should not be musicals. When you're thinking about something for a musical, there's two essential questions. One is, should it be on stage? And two is, should it sing? And so you have to answer those questions. Is there something about the theater and the ways that we make meaning and experience things in the theater that adds value to this idea? And will music add value to that idea? And I think things that are musical have to have an emotional content that's worth exploring in music, that music can add value. Like, yes, you can probably write a song about anything, but in a musical form, will a score help tell this story in a meaningful way? And so you have to answer those questions. I don't think anything can be, people will try to turn anything into a musical, but something that's successful that will reach a target, I don't think anything is.
In your work with Disney, you've worked on some titles specifically for the high school market, the scholastic market, secondary, whatever you want to call it. Is that, again, applying a different process for that audience, for those? How does that market differ from right here in Times Square?
They're different destinations. You know, when we think about musicals, people like Broadway, you know, that's like the holy grail and getting there. But not every project is right for Broadway. Broadway's very expensive. There's a certain audience, there's a certain critical establishment, there's a certain expectation for it. Now, what I think is great about Broadway is that there's no curation process, right? Like, it's all independent, and you just go, and if you can get a theater, great, and what theater that is, who knows, and what comes in what season, like, it's kind of a hodgepodge, so it's democratic in that way. There's no meritocracy there, but it does have value, and I think people know that. And if something can have a Broadway run, however short, it's in perimeter of some sort of something that you've, you know, reached something. But do all shows have their best success on Broadway? Absolutely not. Some things, you know, play better in other markets. Some things can be overexposed on Broadway that are best viewed in a different place. And I've worked on, you know, one of the best things I got to do is be at the ground level of Disney's work on creating shows for young performers, which MTI had started to do with their junior shows. Annie Jr. was the first one, and had pulled the people who are licensing the shows, and like, what new Broadway shows should we make available in this sort of junior 1 hour version for middle school? And what came back were a lot of Disney titles, most of which had never been on Broadway, but were what people thought of as musicals. And so they came to Tom Schumacher, who runs the Disney Theatrical, and sort of pitched the idea. But it was a new venture to try to, like, wow, to like not be able to control the product, but to create something and then like give it to someone else to produce. Was a big was a big risk for the company, I think. But it really paid off because it was giving the content to particularly kids who would then like own it in a different kind of way. Like, you know, you can watch Belle on on your DVD in the movie, or what's DVD? You can stream it, or you can go to the park and maybe meet her. But to actually be her in a sanctioned way is pretty cool. And so the affection for these stories and characters just grew, but it made it extremely important to make sure that those scripts and scores were clear, set young performers up for success, you know, that things have to be in the right key. It has to be accessible. You know, not every story is right for middle school, and to carve that out and present it in a way, like, they can't have speeches that are super long. It's really, you know, you're talking about amateur performers who are young, who are enthusiastic. You need to set them up for success. So really went to school and like, well, what is this? How should we introduce these, you know, kids to these Disney shows in a form that they can do that's, you know, the right amount of accessible and challenging so they can grow, so they can learn about theater. I mean, the great opportunity was using the Disney name to open doors for arts in schools that have been closed to so many. Like, that is such a great thing to be able to do and work on so many shows over time and keep getting better at them and going back and like, some of the first ones we did were like, we can do that better. And so we did it again and, you know, created a new version of those. So yeah, like for schools, there's a different market. And like when adults would try to do some of these scripts, like a TYA model where adults are performing for children, not really good. Stuff kind of felt eggy when we thought of them for young performers when adults were doing it. So we'd create a different model, a different kind of show with different dialogue, different approach that adult professional actors could handle that would then bridge a gap. It's a different kind of audience, something that, you know, we're shooting for Broadway might be different from something we just put out on the road. And some of those are obviously producerial decisions, and some of them have to do with timing. But shows can have a lot of value in other places and create them a little bit differently.
What's your advice to writers out there who are adapting other material, whether it's a movie, whether it's a play, whether it's a book? Because that's different than creating something original on like Hadestown, et cetera.
Yeah.
So what would your advice be to those adapting material?
A, figure out why you love it. Figure out why other people love it. And figure out if you're going to adapt the material, and a lot of particularly musicals have come from other source material and are not original, and that's fine. How does bringing something to the stage and adding a score add value? Is the source material well known? What are people going to bring with them in terms of expectations? Are you going to deliver on those expectations that give people the thing that they've come for, that they already love about the thing, and add value? Otherwise, why are people coming to see something they already know exactly? Because they could probably get it cheaper in some other way. Coming to Broadway is expensive. It's got to be worth it. It's got to have value for the money spent. And that's usually, and with a musical, it's going to be an experience that connects with you emotionally and leaves you higher than when you came in, on the way. Even if it's devastating, it leaves you somehow higher, more human in a way when you leave. So I think like it's a huge thing we're asking of audiences to come to a Broadway show. And so I think we need to think about fundamentally, where's the fire? Where's the thing that's so appealing, that's worth this experience, that's now unique in our culture for people to come together and turn off their phones and their individual access to a million different kinds of experiences and share something communally with other people at a premium price. I do think it's valuable. I do think people are willing to pay for it. It's increasingly valuable, but what are we offering them? And I think that there's got to be something underneath. There's got to be thought behind it. There's got to be some vision to it. You have to know what a thesis. What are you saying? What are you offering here? And in adapting the material, where does it come from? When was this first created? Under what circumstances? What's the equivalent now? Just because something's beloved in a novel or a film, particularly something that's like almost perfect in another medium, you're kind of setting yourself up to fail, right? So how do you add value? Not just translate it to the stage or translate it into score, but how is doing that adding value to it, continuing a conversation and expanding that conversation? And I think you have to answer that question before you go, because so many people are like, well, I just love it and I want to make it a musical. That's not good enough. You've got to answer some harder questions about it. And it's not saying it's not worth doing, just spend some time figuring that out, because you're going to need to convince people to spend money to come see your work.
You've read hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of scripts, I'm sure. What's the most common note you give to writers, or the most common flaw you see in scripts?
I think it's probably the introduction, how you begin a story, which you actually don't quite get right until very late. Because like any kind of writing, you kind of have to write through the first draft, and like sort of by the end, you figure out what you want to do. So then you have to go back and start over and write the beginning again. And you know, even on Hadestown, we worked on the beginning of the show in many different versions, many different ways, to try to figure out what's the right way to open the show. What does the audience need to know? And what's the experience? So I do think when I'm reading scripts, it's like it really is true if you get the advice of like you have to capture the reader, someone's attention in the first 10 pages, just like you have to capture the audience's commitment to your show in the first 10 minutes. And so the opening is like, how do you introduce the world? What am I focusing on? And why should I care? And I think that particularly in musicals, more than plays, it's why should I care? Because I think plays have much more leeway in terms of engaging the brain. Oh, this is interesting. And yes, I have to care on a certain level, but because there's not music involved, I don't have to operate on that frequency necessarily. I can bring my brain to this and have a really interesting, engaging time and fire up my brain. But in a musical, in some way, you have to fire up my heart. And that's gonna be connected to characters that I find appealing in a world that's believable, so I can relax and let my brain still be engaged, but my heart's going to take over. And that operates at a much more complex level.
Okay, my last question, which is my genie question, which you worked on Aladdin, so this is perfect.
I want you to
imagine that genie from Aladdin comes to visit you and thanks you for all your great dramaturgical work on all the stuff you've done, including helping shepherd Hadestown all the way to Broadway and its big wins. What's the one thing that drives you crazy about Broadway, that frustrates you, angers you, makes you want to flip desks over, that you'd ask this genie to wish away in an instant? What would you change about our world if you were a protagonist in it? What would you want to put it in musical theater structure?
What would I wish? I'd wish that the people could come enjoy theater on Broadway as part of a mosaic of what makes theater an important part of culture. That it's not the only place that theater lives and thrives. That it's part of a much wider community, global community, that intersects with Broadway as its capital, but not the entirety of what makes things tick. Because for the most part, it is it is very pricey, and there are ways to get into shows and see them for cheaper. But for me, it's very important that theater is accessible to people and not seen as something like elitist or prohibitive, because I think it forms a very important function in society and our ability to hold ourselves together and be empathetic. And so in as much as Broadway can sort of keep that as the community focus that I think is pretty good about Broadway, and as a place to bring people together instead of a playground for people who can afford it.
Very good wish, and something we're all working towards, and I know you're out there working towards it as well. Thanks so much for that. Thanks so much for listening. Thanks, Ken, for being here today. And we will see you all next time on the Producer's Perspective podcast. Thanks again to Ken for sitting down with this Ken and talking all about dramaturgy. If you are looking for the perfect gift for the Broadway fan in your life, the holidays are a-coming. Get them Broadway's favorite board game designed and created by me. That's right. It's BeABroadwayStar.com. This is our most popular time of the year, as you can imagine, for Be a Broadway Star. We sell a lot of these games, and that means we sell out of these games. It is a no-brainer gift. Everyone loves opening this sucker for the holiday. So go to BeABroadwayStar.com and get it today. Maybe you'll win a Tony Award. If you're excited for this season of podcasts, I hope you'll do us a favor and review us on Apple Podcasts. Just helps other people find us and spread the word about theater and these incredible artists all over the world. So again, give us a review, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, wherever you are. Give us a thumbs up, 5 stars, whatever you can say in a positive way would be much, much appreciated. If you want to find more of what I'm up to every day, follow me on Instagram. It's at Ken Davenport B-Way, or check out and subscribe to my blog at theproducersperspective.com. If you Google Ken Davenport, it'll probably come up. And now, the favorite part of the podcast for so many of you out there, we're going to break another songwriter. This week's hashtag songwriter of the week is Ben Discant and Sammy Horneff. Today we're playing a song from their musical called The Pirate Princess. We could be pirates. Makes sense if it's from a musical called The Pirate Princess. This is We Could Be Pirates from The Pirate Princess from Ben and Sammy. If you like what you hear and want to learn more about what they're doing and about their show, maybe there's a producer out there who wants to produce it, or an agent out there who wants to rep these folks, visit Ben Discant, BENDISKANT.com, and or Sammy Horneff, HORNEFF.com. We're going to put these in links to the blog as well, so go check it out there. Google them, Google Pirate Princess, find these people, show them some love as well, and listen to We Can Be Pirates.
I can see only two choices. We run away scared, or we fight.
Yes!
And wouldn't you rather have weapons to draw when they sneak on our ship in the night? We could be pirates, raise our flag to the sky.